Ooh, hey brothers and sisters, I just made a powerful video. If you've seen it, the last one I just made, I don't know what I'm going to call it. Powerful word, prepare to bride, need to get ready. Anyway, I want to show you guys something. I've seen this a long time ago and I just never talked about it, but this came in my spirit today. I thought I would talk about it. I want to look at Psalm 22 and Deuteronomy, maybe Deuteronomy chapter 3, maybe. Yeah, Deuteronomy chapter 3. All right, in Psalm 22, King David is writing by the Spirit, by the Spirit of God. I just drank a bunch of water. Let's see. In verse 1, he says, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? Hey, it reminds me of the Gospels, right? Yes, of course, this is about the Messiah. Why art thou so far from helping me and from the words of my roaring? Oh, my God, I cry in the daytime, and thou hearest in the night season. Let me keep reading on. He's talking about, this is really like the Lord speaking from the cross, written by King David about 980 years before Christ was born, about 980 B.C., 970 B.C., maybe. Let's see. All right, okay. It's supposed to be Jesus speaking from the cross, prophetically written by King David, at least 1,000 years before it happened. See, verse 12, Psalm 22, verse 12. But bulls have compassed me. That means they're surrounding me. Strong bulls of Bashan have beset me around. They gape upon me. Their mouth is hanging open with their mouths as a ravening and a roaring lion. I'm poured out like water. All my bones are out of joint. My heart is like wax. It melts in the midst of my bowels. You know when they stabbed Jesus in the side of the spear with a spear, his blood and water came out. His heart did melt. It did bust. And he had no broken bones. As it's, you know, this is just some of the prophecies that the Lord fulfilled. I am poured out like water. All my bones are out of joint. My heart is like wax. It is melted in the midst of my bowels. My strength is dried up like a pot sheared, which is an old piece of broken pottery. And my tongue cleaveth to my jaws, and thou hast brought me into the dust of death. For dogs have compassed me. Assembly of the wicked have enclosed me. They pierced my hands and feet. See? And then he says, none of my bones are broken. Verse 17. So, they pierced my hands and feet. You know, crucifixion was not even invented. You know, until, you know, like 100 or 200 B.C., there was no crucifixion at the time that King David wrote this. But yet, King David, speaking by the Spirit, said they pierced my hands and feet. There's lots of more things. There's tons of prophecies in the Old Testament that the Lord fulfilled. You know, there'll be some people who write me, I didn't know that. Well, you got to read your Bible. That's the whole point. But anyway, brothers and sisters, there's something deeper I want to show you in this text. You know, dogs are representing of the land of Canaan. Canine, same word. The dog star, Sirius. Just to tie this into the Great Pyramids and all that, it's all connected. I've made some videos about some of this stuff and mentioned it a little bit. But anyway, I want to go in and talk about, as the days of Noah were, so shall the coming of the Son of Man. We're talking about the return of the Nephilim. You know, we're talking fallen angels, not demons. Demons are the disembodied spirit of the giants. Those creatures, those beasts that were half fallen angel and half man. Genesis chapter 6, men of renown, it says in the King James, men of old, but they were not of renown. They were, it makes it sound like it's something good, but it's not. They were feared. They were giants, and they say they ate people and all that. Just like you hear in all these fairy tales and all that kind of stuff. Yes, fee-fi, fo-fum, I smell the blood of an Englishman. You know, Jack and the Beanstalk. The giants are in the second heaven. Jack climbs the beanstalk into the second heaven. There's the giants, and then they want to eat him. This is, you know, a myth and a fairy tale based off reality, just like the you know, Zeus and the Olympiads and the Clash of the Titans and the Stonehenge and the pyramids and all that stuff. This is all coming from the Nephilim, the fallen angels. That's why there's so much interest in the New Age people in those old, you know, they call it neo-paganism. That's why they're interested in all these monolithic structures like the pyramids and all that, because that is the tie and the connection back to the fallen angels that came down and slept with the daughters of men and created the Nephilim. And the disembodied spirits of the Nephilim are demons. But the fallen angels are the powers and principalities and forces of darkness in high places, brothers and sisters. And the Antichrist, you will find, is a fallen angel named Apollyon, if you read the book of Revelation. But anyway, brothers and sisters, this bulls have compassed me. Strong bulls of Bashan have beset me around. Now let me read something to you, brothers and sisters, about a giant named Og, king of Bashan. He was a giant. He's like 12 feet tall. Deuteronomy chapter 3, verse 1. Then we turned. This is Deuteronomy means a retelling. Deuteronomy is a retelling of Exodus, Numbers, and Leviticus, and the history of what happened to the children in the desert. and Moses is speaking, and they're recording it. It says, then we turned and went the way of Bashan. Remember the bulls of Bashan? Let me add something in here. The book of Enoch, which was in the Bible for about 800 years and removed by the Jewish scholars, they hated it because it referred so much to the Messiah, to Christ, Jesus Christ as the Messiah, so much that they took it out and they hated it. And they thought it was a fake. But a copy of the book of Enoch was found in the Dead Sea Scrolls about 200 years before, you know, it's 200 years B.C. 200 B.C. is the date of the copy of the book of Enoch, long before Jesus was ever born. So it is definitely written before Christ. That doesn't prove it was written by the Enoch from the Bible, but it's greatly quoted from and alluded to throughout the Bible. Here's an example. In the book of Enoch, Enoch has a vision of these bulls that come down and sleep with earthly cows. These, you know, these evil bulls that sleep with earthly cows and have these giants. You know, it's a parable and a metaphor and a dream that Enoch has that shows about the Nephilim. He tells the whole story of that. Anyway, it's awesome. Go read it in the book of Enoch. Anyway, so here's an allusion to that. Here's an allusion to that. And this is all tied into Jesus said, as the days of Noah were, so shall the coming of the Son of Man be. What was going on in the days of Noah? It just wasn't that people getting married and giving in marriage. That part is saying, yeah, life was going on like it normally does. But what was unique about the days of Noah? Go read. The unique thing was, is there were Nephilim, there were giants on the earth. That was what was unique about those days. Anyway, in verse 2, and the Lord said unto me, fear him not, for I, verse 1, let me see. We went to Deuteronomy 3:1. Then we turned and we went up the way to Bashan, and Og, the king of Bashan, came out against us, he and all his people, at the battle of Edrei. And the Lord said unto me, fear him not, for I will deliver him and all his people and his land into thy hand, and thou shalt do unto him all that all thou didst unto the Shihon, king of Amorites, which dwelt in the Heshbon. Let's see. So the Lord God delivered into our hands Og also, the king of Bashan, and all his people, and we smote him until none were left to remain him. Let's see. It says, took it all the cities of the kingdom of Og. Let's see. These cities were fenced with great walls, gates, and bars beside unwalled towns, a great many. We utterly destroyed. Let's see. I'm trying to read in there what it tells about how big is his bed. It's in there. Og, king of Bashan, to see. It says right here. This is the King James. Verse 11. For only Og, king of Bashan, remained of the remnants of the giants. Don't let these religious people confuse you about the meaning of this text. Let me tie that. Let me say this, as the Lord is just speaking to me while I was trying to find this. The whole point, God prophesied to the serpent and to Eve and to Adam, and he said that the seed of the serpent would try to, you know, that the seed of the woman, Jesus is the only, every man, every human born is the seed of a man. The man is the one with the seed. Okay, semen. Okay, I'm trying to not say too many words in this video. You know, it's a Christian video, but it's medical here. So the seed is of a man, but Jesus is the only one who didn't have a father, an earthly father. So he's the one that his DNA is from the woman. He's the seed of a woman. Jesus is the only one who had no earthly father. So he's the only one that's the seed of a woman. All other people are the seed of a man, except for, you know, Adam and Eve and Jesus. And so anyway, that's who you're talking about, the seed of the woman. And so it says that the seed of the woman would crush the head of the serpent, you know, the seed of the serpent. So that was Jesus dying on the cross. As a matter of fact, Jesus even literally bruised his heel on the cross as he pushed up to draw breath. It's a whole other story to get into, you know, in a neat little detail. But anyway, so the devil sought out to stop that. That's why the fallen angels came. That's why they slept with the daughters of man, because they wanted to contaminate the seed of the woman. They wanted to contaminate the human bloodline. So after the children of Israel went through all they went through, and then they came out of the Egypt, out of bondage with Moses, what happened? As soon as they get to the promised land, if you go read Exodus, you go read Deuteronomy and read this, you will see that the promised land was inhabited by giants. They were all over the place. That's why the children of Israel were afraid to go in the land. That's why there were 10 spies who didn't believe the word of the Lord, and 2, Jacob, Joshua and Caleb, who did. 2 spies who were honored by God because they had the good report that God will make a way for us. The other ones, everybody else believed the bad report. That's why they were sentenced by God to spend 40 years wandering in the wilderness. Because there were giants in the land, they were afraid. They said, we're like grasshoppers compared to these people. They're giants. You know, they said one bunch of grapes was carried by two men between poles, you know. One bunch of grapes was so big in the promised land, the land of Canaan, the land of Canaan, the land of, you know, the dog star, way back in the time of the fallen ones. I can go into all that. I mentioned some of this in my videos way back, brothers and sisters. I'm just skipping through it right now. This is the bottom line facts of these things. So anyway, Og of King of Bashan. Okay, here are these giants in the land. Why? They're there. That's why God, you know, people say, why did God have them kill all the people and kill all their animals and everything? Because there were giants. The devil's people were there trying to contaminate the bloodline again. That's why, you know, there are people who are racist, brothers and sisters. Maybe you've seen like the Worldwide Church of God, it's Armstrongism, all these, you know, racists. There are black people on YouTube that are racist, that Jesus was black, everybody's black, anybody that's not black, and blue-eyed devils, all this. There are white people who are Nazis and neo-Nazis and Klansmen and all that, who use the Bible where, you know, God spoke through Moses, hey, don't interbreed with the local people, you know, to support racism and racial purity. But in reality, God did that because he didn't want them to interbreed with the giants to contaminate the bloodline. Because if the bloodline of Israel was contaminated, then of course Jesus, the Messiah's birth would have been stopped by, that was Satan's plan, to corrupt the seed of the woman so the Messiah couldn't come. See how easy the Bible is to understand when you hear the truth and you read the Bible through what is, you know, what's the real motive behind what God's doing? So God's not a hater and a killer and want to kill all these people, as the devil's children say, and Larry King says, and all these people talking about it. No, God had a reason, because it was contaminated. They were beasts. They were freaks. They were not humans. They had contaminated blood because of the fallen angels. So here is the children of Israel after the flood, after God had destroyed, you know, the Nephilim and all that. Even as Moses wrote in Genesis chapter 6, before and after the flood, there were giants. He said before and after. God sent the flood to destroy them. Obviously, some more fallen angels came down and slept with the daughters of man, because we see giants all the way to Goliath. Even though Goliath wasn't as tall as this guy, Goliath was still a giant, and there were five of them who were killed there by David and his mighty men, Goliath being one of them, that was killed there by King David later on in the life of King David. So the devil was trying to contaminate the bloodline of the Jewish people to stop the Messiah from coming. So here, verse 11, for only Og, king of Bashan, remained of the remnant of the giants. Behold, his bedstead was a bedstead of iron, and it is in, is it not in Raboth of the children of Ammon? So the bed was still there at the time this book was written. 9 cubits was the length thereof, and 4 cubits was the width thereof, after the cubit of the man. So a cubit is basically from the tip of your elbow to the bottom of your finger. It's a rough estimate of what is a cubit. So it's really like a yard, a modern-day yard. That's another reason why. I've talked about this before. The metric system is from the devil, and I'll tell you why. Because the American system that we use, it came from England, the imperial system, is actually very close, almost exactly the same as the measurements in the Bible. Almost exactly. The metric system destroys that connection. The imperial system that we use in the United States, I think we're one of the only countries that still uses it. It is a direct ancient connection back to the biblical measurements from the beginning of man. And that's why the American measurements, you know, the imperial system is much better, because it connects us right back to being able to understand the biblical measurements much better. Much better, brothers and sisters, than this metric. It totally removes people from, you know, relating to the biblical measurements and God's measurements, like the, you know, the cubit and the pyramid inch, you know, and then, you know, and all those things. Ours and stuff is almost exactly the same, the American measurements. Anyway, brothers and sisters, I'll just throw that out there. So anyway, so I covered that. So here, when Jesus is on the cross, he's talking about the dogs are encompassed about me, the bulls of Bashan are encompassed about me. Who's he talking about? He's talking about the fallen angels. He's talking about those demons, the fallen angels and demons. That's what he's talking about. Actually, the bulls of Bashan are fallen angels. Here's their offspring, like this Og, king of Bashan, and Goliath, and all those different ones from the Old Testament. See, so we see that that's a spiritual battle that the Lord was in. And King David knew that. He was talking about that. He was referring to the book of Enoch, that, and by the Spirit of God, that when the Lord was on the cross in the spirit world that we can't see, you know, that unless God gives us. Now, you know what? I just want to say this, as I'm always connecting stuff. People keep talking about, oh, I've got discernment. I've got the spirit of discernment. Most of the people are just judgmental Pharisees when they say they have the spirit of discernment. The real spirit of discernment, brothers and sisters, it says discernment of spirits. Now, what that means, biblical supernatural gift of discernment. All those religious people always tell me, what gift? And I say to them, what gift would you like to let the, you know, when I, people, you know, I'll pray for them. What gift would you like the Lord to give you? Because it says he divides them severally among us as he wills. You know, another lie that religious people say is that he can only give you one. It says divided severally among us as he wills. So you could have two or three or four gifts of the Spirit. 1 Corinthians chapter 12. But they'll always say, religious people, if you want to hear what a religious person will say, a Pharisee will always say, I think I already have the gift of discernment, and I would love to have the gift of discernment. That's where I operate. No, you're usually just a judgmental person and a self-righteous Pharisee. That's really what you are. That's natural discernment. Supernatural discernment of spirits is being able to see into the spirit world. It's like what King David was saying. You know, these bulls of Bashan compass about me. These dogs are around me. You know, referring to the dogs really... As you know, the Lord is just giving me the wisdom right now. I never even thought about it. The dogs refer to the demons, the offspring. You know, a bull is big. And as Enoch was, tells us, the bulls represent fallen angels. The dogs, the Canaanites, the Canaans, they refer, the canines, that is their offspring. Even though giants are big, even though giants are big, spiritually, they're small. Demons are little imps, brothers and sisters. If you want to know the hierarchy of how things go in the spirit world, even though demons, it's so ironic. Isn't that ironic that the spirit of the beast, of these fallen angels, you know, fallen angels are big, but, you know, they came in the form of a man and slept with women, and then their offspring were giants. You know, it's like a tiger and a lion mixed together. You know, one, if one is a male, it makes a giant one, and then the other one, it makes a little tiny one. So, obviously, you know, with in God's creation, when an angel sleeps with a human woman, it makes this, you know, a physical giant, but its spirit, the beast spirit, it's really small. That's why demons are just little imps. Now, dealing with a fallen angel, a power and principality and forces of darkness in high places, a principality is a whole different thing than dealing down here with a demon, you know, a little imp demon, you know, that is at the bottom of the army of Satan. These things are all real, brothers and sisters. They're alluded to throughout the Word of God. And let me just throw another illusion from the Word of God in there to connect this for you and nail it down. That there is a real discernment of spirits. So there is a real spirit world. There's really going things going on around us that we know very little about unless God would open your eyes and let you have discernment of spirits and see. And it's this. As an example, when Daniel prayed and fasted for 21 days, it took 21 days for Gabriel to get to him. And Gabriel, when he got there, in the book of Daniel, Gabriel said, you know, behold thou, Daniel, you know, beloved of God, I've been trying to answer you from the day you prayed. I've been trying to get here and give you the answer from God. But the prince of Persia withstood me for 21 days until Michael, your prince. This is one way we know that the archangel Michael is the principality. You know, people think of principalities as being evil, but there's also, you know, God's princes. So Michael, your prince. So Michael is the principality of holy angel principality over the nation of Israel. Whereas the principality over Persia was a fallen angel who withstood Gabriel and was able to withstand him and stop him from coming and talk to Daniel because Daniel was in the Persian kingdom. So that fallen angel had authority over Persia. That's how he had the authority to withstand Gabriel until the prince of Israelites, Michael, who is the had authority over Daniel because Daniel was an Israelite and he was able to go through. Now, I'm just touching on this and giving a little wisdom and hinting at, you know, the hierarchy. There's a principality over homosexuality. There's a principality over alcoholism. But yet there's also a principality over the United States. There's a principality over California, San Francisco, whatever. All these different levels of evil places and places has lots of Christians and places with few Christians. Don't let anybody fool you. You go to a place where there's hardly no Christians, and you, if you have any kind of a spiritual feeling and discernment in the feeling area, not seeing, but spiritual discernment of feeling spiritual things, you will know that you're in darkness in a dark place, and there's not many Christians around. Like when I go to the Philippines, I can feel it. Philippines is only about 5% born-again Christian. Huge difference than living in, you know, going to the Bible Belt area of the United States where there's lots of Christians or some other Christian country. In the world, there's lots of Christians. You can tell a big difference, brothers and sisters. But, you know, you're just, you know, discerning and feeling those powers and principalities. You're feeling and discerning those minions underneath that, whether it be holy angels, you know, under the authority of Michael or whomever is a holy angel principality over, you know, the United States versus, you know, the satanic fallen angel principality and his demons over a certain area. Anyway, brothers and sisters, I've rambled on and on and on. It's my second video. God bless you guys. Love you guys. Hey. These message that I gave you, says the Lord, is to give you a hunger for His Word. The last video I made was to give you a hunger for His Spirit. And this second video I'm making, the Lord says He wants to give you a hunger for His Word. And blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness. They shall be filled. Hallelujah. I beseech thee in the name of Jesus Christ that you have a holy desire to be filled with His Word, to renew your mind with His Word, to bring every vain imagination, every thought into captivity to the Word of God, and then let the Spirit of God rule in mind your heart through Christ Jesus. May His Spirit be upon you. May it rest upon you right now and give you a spirit of peace. I speak right now. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May His face shine upon you. May He lift up His countenance over you and give you peace. I speak it right now in the name of Jesus Christ, Yeshua HaMashiach, the Son of the living God. Peace be still in the name of Jesus. I release right now the anointing of peace upon you right now in the name of Jesus Christ. As far as the east is from the west, so shall your sins be from you, the Bible says. For if you confess your sins, He is just and faithful to forgive you of your sins and cleanse you of all unrighteousness. 1 John 1:9. May the peace of the Lord be with you today, brothers and sisters. God bless you. If you want to get some anointing oil, go to the website. It's under here. I'll send you some. Praise be God. It's something the Lord gave me to do. If you want a copy of the book, it's on the same website. I got people ordering books and oil. Hallelujah. How about that? A sister gave me some envelopes. Sister Rosemary already gave me envelopes for the books so I can stick the oil in there. Hey, it's all good, brothers and sisters. Praise God for my brothers and sisters in Christ. Praise God for all of you. I love you all in the name of the Lord. Thank you for your prayers. I'm praying for you. Pray for me. Hey, together we can put thousands and millions to flight of the enemy's camp. God bless.